Okay, so question four, what is the main benefit of the principle of loose coupling? So remember, we've discussed loose coupling before, and it's a way that you can kind of separate your application components from each other and send information between them so that you're kind of separating them so they can scale independently and perform independently. So let's look at these descriptions here. Does loose coupling reduce interdependencies so a failure in one component does not cascade to other components? Well, that is actually one of the benefits of loose coupling. So I like that. Let's just select that option. Does it enable applications to scale automatically based on current demand? Well, that's more like something like auto-scaling rather than loose coupling. Does it automate the deployment of infrastructure using code? That tells me maybe cloud formation would be the answer, you know, would be the solution that would provide that. And does it reduce operational complexity? Well, not really. If anything, it adds to complexity because, you know, you have extra layers in there. So I'm going to stick with this first option here. Click on check. And that's certainly the correct answer. Now let's have a look at a diagram. So this diagram just helps you understand what decoupling is. So imagine you have a web tier and an app tier. So you've got EC2 instances in each. With a direct integration, you're coupling these together. So each of these instances is attached straight to these ones. So what happens if the web tier suddenly gets a huge amount of demand and it's passing information on which needs to be processed here? Well, they need to be able to keep up with that load. And that could be a problem. With decoupling, that doesn't happen. So the web tier will place messages in a queue, and then these instances will poll the queue, retrieve the messages, and process the data. And that can happen independently. So, you know, issues that occur here don't affect this tier, and this tier and this tier can both scale independently because the messages will go in the queue. So there could be a backlog, but they'll get processed at some point. So question five asks, which of the below is a fully managed Amazon search service based on open source software? And we've got a few answers here. So is Elastic Beanstalk used for searching? Well, no, we know that that's used as a platform service for running websites, and it automates, you know, the deployment and management of your resources. OpsWorks is a configuration management service that uses Chef and Puppet. So Amazon Cloud Search, well, that is a sort of service that's used for searching, but is it based on open source software? Because you've got to check the wording sometimes in these questions. So we're looking not only for a fully managed Amazon search service, but it has to be based on open source software. Now, Cloud Search isn't. I know that this is actually a proprietary technology from Amazon. Amazon Elasticsearch is actually based on open source software, and it allows you to search for and analyze and visualize data in real time. So let's just check that one. And that's correct. We have a bit more data here to explain to you how it works. So let's click on next and go to the question number six. Which AWS service can be used to prepare and load data for analytics using an extract, transform, and load process? So sounds quite complicated, but these questions do actually come up on the Cloud Practitioner exam. But you know, you just need to understand at a very basic level which service is responsible for this particular task. Now, what ETL is, for instance, you might have a database and you need to migrate the data to another database, but the two types of database are completely incompatible with each other. So you extract the data from one, you perform transformation, and then you load that data into the new database, and it's been transformed into the correct format. So that's one use case for ETL, and you can actually use an AWS service to do that for you. So which one is it? Well, we know Lambda is used for functions, so you can run your code as a function. We've got AWS Glue here. Well, AWS Glue looks like the right answer because it is actually an ETL service. So I'm going to select that one, and let's check the other two. So Elastic MapReduce is a hosted Hadoop service, so that's not going to be correct. And Amazon Athena is related to Glue, but remember, Athena is the serverless service that you use for querying data on Amazon S3. But for ETL, you would use Glue. So let's just click on check, and that's the correct answer. So let's move on and just have a look at a diagram here. And this is actually Athena with Glue, so you can use these two services together. So Athena is used for querying data in S3 using structured query language, SQL. And what Glue does is it can actually discover data can transform it and prepare it for analytics. And then Glue will provide a unified view of the data through the Glue data catalog that Athena and some other services are able to use. So that's how you might use Amazon Athena with AWS Glue. On to question 7. Which AWS service is designed to be used for operational analytics? So let's go through these in order. Is Amazon Elastic MapReduce used for operational analytics? Well, it is used for analytics, but it's a Hadoop service. It's not really for operational analytics. And Athena is a serverless service that's used for querying data on S3. Whereas QuickSight is a business intelligence service. So that kind of leaves us with the last one here, Elasticsearch, which we came up against a few minutes ago. And Elasticsearch is something that you can use for operational analytics. So let's go and check that one just to be sure. And let's head down and have a look at the explanation here. So Elasticsearch is involved with operational analytics such as application monitoring, log analytics, and clickstream analytics. And the important thing to note here is it allows you to perform several actions in real time or near real time, such as searching, exploring, filtering, aggregating, and visualizing data. So that's it for this section. So hopefully you know a bit more now about some of the tools used for both application integration as well as analytics.